Good morning, students. Today we will see the solved question paper of microbiology 2020, that means November 2020 of 2010 scheme. So the first essay is define immunity, describe the factors affecting innate immunity. Immunity means the Latin word immunes, that is named free of burden. It refers to a resistance exhibited by the host towards injury caused by microorganisms and their products. The factors influencing the level of immunity are, first one is age. Fetus in utero, the 2x life carries high susceptibility to infectious disease as compared with adults. The fetus in utero is protected from adult infections by plasmid barrier, but some pathogens cross this barrier causing overwhelming infections leading to fetal death, while others such as toxoplasma, rubella, herpes, cytomegalovirus lead to congenital malformation. And second group is the elderly. It besides general waning of the activities of the immune system, physical abnormalities, for example, prostatic enlargement leading to stasis of urine or long-term exposure to environmental factors like smoking are common causes of increased susceptibility to the infection. Next is factors affecting individual innate immunity. First is age. As we already said, very young and very old are most susceptible to the infectious disease. And second is hormonal influence. Endocrine disorders like diabetes, hyperthyroidism, adrenal dysfunction are associated with enhanced sensitivity to infections. High incidence of staphylococcal sepsis in diabetes is due to the increased level of carbohydrates in tissues. Corticosteroid hormones have anti-inflammatory and anti-phagocytic effect which depress host resistance. Elevated steroid level during pregnancy result in increased sensitivity to many infections. Third is nutrition. Malnutrition which causes reduced self-mediated and humoral immunity. Self-mediated immune response decreases in severe protein deficiency. And fourth is sex. There is no marked difference in sensitivity to infections between the sexes. In general, incidence and death rate from infectious disease are greater in males than in females. Stress. A growing body of evidence has demonstrated an inverse relation between stress and immune function. The end result is increased sensitivity to infection. Second essay is named two bacteria causing enteric fever. Describe mode of transmission, laboratory diagnosis and prophylaxis of enteric fever. Enteric fever, otherwise known as typhoid fever, is a systemic disease characterized by fever and abdominal pain caused by dissemination of Salmonella typhi or Salmonella paratyphi type A, B or C. The mode of transmission is transmitted by consumption of contaminated food or water. Occasionally, direct fecal-oral transmission may occur. Shellfish taken from sewage-polluted areas are an important source of infection. Transmission also occurs through eating raw fruit and vegetables fertilized by human excreta and through ingestion of contaminated milk and milk products. Flies may cause human infections through transfer of infectious agent to the foods. Pollution of water sources may produce epidemics of typhoid fever when large numbers of people use the same source of drinking water. Laboratory diagnosis. The infection with typhoid or paratyphoid fever resulted with very low-grade septicemia. Blood culture is usually positive only. Half the cases is not usually positive during the acute phase of the disease. Bone marrow culture increases the diagnostic yield to about 80% of the cases. The vital test is an old serological assay for detecting IgM and IgG antibodies to the O and H antigens of Salmonella. The test is unreliable, but it is widely used in developing countries because of its low cost. Newer serologic assays are somewhat more sensitive and specific than viral tests, but they are infrequently available. Bacteremia occurs early in the disease. Blood cultures are positive first week around 90% and second week around 75%, third week by 60% and by fourth week and later it decreased to 25%. The prophylaxis of enteric fever. Access to safe water and adequate sanitation hygiene among food handlers and typhoid vaccination are all effective preventing typhoid fever. Two vaccines have been used for many years to protect people from typhoid fever. They are, first one is injectable vaccine based on purified antigen for the people aged over 2 years, a lip attenuated oral vaccine in capsule formulation for people aged over 5 years. These vaccines do not provide long-lasting immunity and are not approved for children younger than 2 years of age. The following recommendations will ensure safety. First, ensure food is properly cooked and still hot when served. Avoid raw milk and products made from raw milk. Drink only pasteurized boiled milk. Avoid ice and the cities made from safe water. When the safety of drinking water is questionable, boil it, or if it is not possible, disinfectant with reliable slow-release disinfectant agent. Wash hands thoroughly and frequently using soap, in particular after contact with pets or farm animals or after having been to the toilet. Wash fruits and vegetables carefully, particularly if they are eaten raw. If possible, vegetables and fruits should be peeled. Short notes. The first one is bacteria growth count. If a suitable liquid medium is inoculated with bacteria, incubated growth follows the definitive course. Small samples are taken at regular intervals after inoculation and plotted in relation to time. A plotting of data will yield a characteristic growth curve. The changes of slope on such graph indicate transition from one phase of the development to another. The phases of bacterial growth curve, that is the bacterial growth curve, can be divided into two major phases. First is lag phase, second is exponential or logarithmic phase, third is stationary phase, and fourth one is decline phase. These phases reflect the physiological state of organisms in the culture at that particular time. First one is lag phase. When microorganisms are introduced into the fresh culture medium, usually no immediate increase in the cell number occurs and therefore periodic lag phase. Log phase. Following the lag phase, the cells start dividing and their numbers increase exponentially or by geometric progression with time. If the logarithm of the viable count is plotted against time, the straight line will be obtained. Stationary phase. After varying period of exponential growth, cell division stops due to depletion of nutrients and accumulation of toxic products. Eventually, growth slows down and total bacterial cell number reaches a maximum and stabilizes. Decline or death phase. The death phase is a period when population decreases due to cell death. Eventually, the rate of death exceeds the rate of reproduction and the number of viable cells decline. This is the picture of a bacterial growth curve which plot against number of cells and the time. The fourth question is microfilaria. Microfilaria is an early stage in the life cycle of parasitic nematodes in the family of Oncrocete. The adults live in tissues and circulatory system of vertebrates. They release microfilaria into the bloodstream of vertebrae host. Microfilaria are taken up by the blood-feeding anthropoid vectors. In the intermediate host of the microfilaria, develop into infective larvae that can be transmitted to a new vertebrate host. Source and transmissions. The epidemiology of filarial worms is determined by temperature, rainfall, factors affecting the reproduction of vector flies. Following mating, female worms release microfilaria which are picked up by vector insects while feeding on the host blood. Microfilaria mulch and develop into infective larvae which are injected into the dermis layer of the skin. After 1 year, the larvae molt twice in the adult worms. Clinical findings and lesions. The blood-sucking flies and even house flies transmit this disease. Filaried worms form nodules in the skin, lay eggs, and microfilaria nodules bleed and ulcerate. Although these lesions are inconvenient to the animal, ulcers heal spontaneously. Treatment. No effective treatment is available. Topical treatment with organophosphorus compounds reduce the number and burden of parafilaria lesions. Secondary skin infections and suppurations should be treated with basic wound management techniques and fly strike prevention. Controlled of filarial worms focus on decreasing microfilaria in blood and eradicating adult worms on skin and the vector flies. Vector control carried out by using environmental safe insecticides applied by aerial spraying over a breeding site of flies is recommended. Laboratory diagnosis of gas gangrene. Specimens include edge of the affected muscles, x-rays from the wounds and necrotic tissue and muscle fragments. Second, for microscopy, gram stain fillings give presumptive information about species of Clostridia present and their relative numbers. If gas gangrene is present, gram positive rods may predominate. Thick, stubby gram positive rods with Clostridium perfringens or Clostridium solidale, citron bodies, spot or leaf shaped pleomorphic bacilli with irregular staining may indicate clonal septicum. Slender rods with round terminal spores is Clostridium tetani, and large rods with oval subterminal spores indicate Clostridium novae. Culture. Fresh and heated blood agar is used for aerobic and anaerobic cultures to prevent swarming by the subspecies of Clostridium. Plates containing increased agar to 5 to 6% are considered. A plate of serum or egg yolk agar with Clostridium perfringens antitoxin spread on the half is used for the Naegeler's reactions. Identification. Examine the plates for typical colonies. The isolates are identified based on their morphological, cultural, biochemical and toxigenic characteristics. Gas gangrene is a medical emergency. The diagnosis of gas gangrene must be made primarily on clinical grounds, and the function of the laboratory is only to provide confirmation of the clinical diagnosis as well as identification and enumeration of the infecting organism. Candidiasis. Candida albicans is an opportunistic fungal pathogen that is responsible for candidiasis in human host. Candida albicans grow in several different morphological forms ranging from unicellular budding yeast to true hyphae with parallel sidewall. Candida albicans is unicellular, oval-shaped, diploid fungus. Typically, Candida albicans live in harmless commensals of the GI tract and genital urinary tract and count over 70% of the population. Overgrowth of this organism, however, will lead to the disease. Candidiasis is a fungal infection that can affect areas such as skin, genitals, crotch, mouth, blood. There are several types of candidiasis. If it is in the mouth or throat, it is called as oral candidiasis, oral pharyngeal candidiasis, or oral thrush. If it affects genital area, it is called yeast infection. In women, it may be called a vulvovaginal yeast infection. If the yeast infection infects skin on a baby's bottom area or the buttocks area, it is called a diaper rash. If the infection enters bloodstream, it is called invasive candidiasis or candidemia. Pathogenesis. Candidiasis is caused by abnormal growth in Candida albicans, which is usually due to an imbalance in the environment. Usually, this imbalance occurs in a woman's vagina. This infection is less likely to occur for men. Several events can spark for imbalance. For example, antibiotic use can decrease the amount of lactobacillus bacteria, which decrease the amount of acidic products and pH of the vagina. Other events are pregnancy, uncontrolled diabetes, impaired immune system, and irritation of vagina. Candida albicans are able to take advantage of the conditions and outcompete normal microflora, resulting in candidiasis or a yeast infection. Transmission. Candida albicans usually transmit from mother to infant with childbirth and remains as a part of normal human microflora. Overgrowth of Candida albicans to symptoms of disease, and it occurs when there are imbalances, for example, change in the normal acidity of vagina. Candida albicans infections very rarely spread through sexual intercourse. Typical reservoir of the Candida albicans is the normal human microflora and not found in animal vectors. Diagnosis. Diagnosis of an yeast infection is done either by a microscopic examination or by culturing. The treatment. Cutaneous candidiasis, the skin infection can be effectively treated with variety of antifungal powders and creams. The affected area must be kept clean and dry with protective film chaffing. Deep candidiasis, this infection usually treated with intravenous fluconazole. Laboratory diagnosis of HIV. Laboratory procedure for the diagnosis of HIV infection includes specific tests for HIV and tests for immunodeficiency as well. The evidence of infection by HIV can be detected in three ways. First, by specific test for HIV infection, second by non-specific test, and third by test for opportunistic infections and tumors. Specific test. First is antigen detection. The virus antigens may be detectable in the blood after about 2 weeks following a single massive infection, as by the blood transfusion. the major core antigen P24 is the earliest virus marker to be appear in the blood and is one tested for IgM antibodies appearing about 4 to 6 weeks to be followed by IgG antibodies. The P24 antigen capture assay or ELISA, which uses anti-P24 antibody as the solid phase, can be used for this. The test is most useful in persons recently exposed to the risk of infection in whom antibody test is negative. Second is viral isolation. Once infected with HIV, a person remains infected for life. The virus is present in circulation and body fluids within lymphocytes or cell-free. It can be isolated from CD4 lymphocytes or peripheral blood, bone marrow and serum. The technique of isolation by co-cultivation of patient's lymphocytes and with uninfected lymphocytes in the presence of interleukin-2. Detection of viral nucleic acid. As the most sensitive and specific test is PCR, become gold standard for the diagnosis of all stages of HIV infection. PCR tests are complex and are indicated only when other methods cannot give a definitive result. Two forms of PCR can be used, DNA PCR and RNA PCR. Fourth one is antibody detection. Demonstration of antibodies is the simplest and most widely employed technique for diagnosis of HIV infection. Non-specific tests are immunological tests following parameters to help establish immune deficiency in HIV infection. Total leukocyte and lymphocyte count demonstrate leukopenia and the lymphocyte count usually below 2000 mm³/mm. T cell subset assays. Platelet count will show thrombocytopenia, raised IgG and IgA level, diminished CMI as indicated by skin test, lymph node biopsy showing profound abnormalities. Test for opportunistic infection and tumors. Apart from diagnosing HIV infection, laboratory would be called upon to identify opportunistic infections and other features of AIDS. Routine microbiological methods would be suffice for this. However, serological diagnosis for infections cannot be always be reliable in AIDS as antibody formation may be affected by the immune deficiency. Meningococcal meningitis. The third stage of meningococcal infection, the organism can cross blood-brain barrier and infect the meninges, causing major symptoms of severe headache, stiff neck and vomiting accompanied by delirium and confusion. The route of spread from nasopharynx to the meninges is controversial, but the spread may be directly along the perineural sheath of olfactory nerve to the cribriform plate to the subarachnoid space or more probably to the bloodstream. In certain cases, the site of entry for meningococcus may be conjunctiva. Cases of meningococcal purulent conjunctivitis occur. On reaching central nervous system, a suppurative lesion of the meninges is set up involving the surface of the spinal cord as well as the base and cortex of the brain. The cocci are invariably found in the spinal fluid, both free and within the leukocyte. The case fatality is variable, but in untreated cases it may be high as 80%. Survivors may have sequelae such as blindness and deafness. Some cases develop chronic or recurrent meningitis. Laboratory diagnosis, first based on specimens, first is cerebrospinal fluid, second is blood culture which comes from a patient with meningitis, a hemorrhagic rash or pyrexia of uncertain origin, aspirate from skin lesions or pus from infected joint, throat or nasopharyngeal swabs from suspected cases, swabs should be transported in Stewart's transport medium. All specimens with meningococcal infection suspected must be submitted to the laboratory immediately. Treatment, penicillin is currently the antibiotic of choice, but resistance is also becoming more common. Intravenous penicillin G is the treatment of choice. Chloramphenicol is effective, but the risk of blood dysgeusia has been limited to its use. Either chloramphenicol or a third generation cephalosporin, ceftriaxone or ceftriaxone is used in persons allergic to penicillin. Biomedical based management. According to biomedical based rules in 1998 of India, biomedical based means any waste generated during the diagnosis, treatment or immunization of human beings or animals or research activities pertaining thereto or production of or testing of biologicals. Infectious pests include all those medical pests which are potential to transmit viral, bacterial, parasitic disease. It includes both normal human and animal infectious pests and pests generated in laboratories and veterinary practice. Infectious pests is hazardous in nature. Any pest with potential to pose a threat to human health and life is called hazardous pest. Steps in management of biomedical waste include generation, accumulation, handling, storage, treatment, transportation, and disposal. The development of implementation of the National Waste Management Policy can improve biomedical waste management health facilities in a country. General principles of waste management include: first is effective waste management requires a clean and tidy environment since waste tend to accumulate dirty surroundings. Hospital and premises should be maintained in a clean and hygienic state. If this requires frequent soap and water washing, mopping, and good housekeeping practices. The objectives of biomedical waste are to prevent harm resulting waste, minimize its volume, retrieve reusable materials, and ensure safe and economical disposal. Steps in waste management. First, reduction in volume can be achieved by proper planning and using reusable items whenever safely possible. Segregation. This refers to separation of waste at the point of generation into various types with respect to the category and mode. When potentially harmful waste is mixed with harmless waste such as paper or packing materials, entire lot become contaminated and will have to be autoclaved instead of only originally infected items. Storage refers to measures taken to ensure the biomedical waste is safely at the point of generation before being sent to the biomedical waste treatment facility. Transportation refers to movement of waste from point of generation to the treatment facility. Treatment here means all procedures and processes needed to reduce the bulk of the waste. Waste categories: category number 1, human anatomical waste; category number 2, animal waste; category number 3, microbiological or biotechnological waste; category number 4, waste of sharps like needles, syringes; 5, discarded medicine, cytotoxic waste; 6, soiled waste; and 7 is soiled waste, which generate when disposable items like catheters, intravenous set; category number 8, liquid waste; category number 9, incineration waste, ash from the incinerator; and category number 10, chemical waste, chemical used in production of biological chemicals and disinfectant. Different type of waste, quantity of the waste, differentiate the types of waste with the quantity of the waste generator, determine the points of generation, determine the level of generation. It refers to basic separation and different categories, segregation, effective segregation. MMR vaccine. MMR vaccine is a vaccine against measles, mumps, and rubella. The first dose is generally given to children around 9 months to 15 months of age, with second dose around 15 months of 6 years of age, with at least 4 weeks between the doses. After 2 doses, 97% of people are protected against measles, 88% against mumps, and at least 97% against rubella. It is live-attenuated vaccine contraindicated in pregnancy. MMR vaccine administered by subcutaneous injection, its second dose may be given as early as 1 month after the first dose. Second dose is a dose to produce immunity in the small number of persons who fail to develop measles immunity after the first dose. Name for common infections caused by Staphylococcus are cutaneous infections, include infection wound and burn infection, fringles, boils, deep infections like osteomyelitis, periosteate, tonsillitis, pharyngitis, sinusitis, bronchopneumonia. Mandom steps. This is tool for screening tuberculosis and diagnosis. It's one of the major tuberculin skin testing around the world. Mandox is a standard of 5 tuberculin units injected intradermally on a flexor surface of the left forearm, midway between elbow and wrist. Injection should be made with tuberculin syringe. When placed correctly, injection should be produced a pale beam of skin 6 to 10 mm in diameter. The result of the test is read after 48 to 96 hours, but 72 hours is ideal. A person who has been exposed to bacteria is expected to mount an immune response in the skin containing bacterial proteins. The response is a classical example of delayed type of hypersensitivity reaction. Dengue fever. Dengue fever is the mosquito-borne tropical disease caused by dengue virus. Symptoms typically begin 3 to 14 days after the infection. This may include high fever, headache, vomiting, muscle and joint pains, and characteristic of skin rash. Recovery generally takes 2 to 7 days. Small portion of cases, the disease develops into more severe dengue hemorrhagic fever, resulting in bleeding, low levels of platelets and blood plasma leakage, or into dengue shock syndrome, which is dangerously low blood pressure occurs. IgM. The normal serum level of IgM is 1.2 mg per ml. It has a half-life of about 5 days. IgM is the first immunoglobulin appear after exposure to antigen. IgM agglutinates bacteria, activates complement by classical pathway and enhances the injection of pathogens by phagocytic cells. IgM is normally restricted to the intravascular space because of the high molecular weight. Also, the earliest to be synthesized by the fetus beginning about 20 weeks of age. As it cannot cross the placenta barrier, the presence of IgM in the fetus or newborn indicate intrauterine infection. Detection is therefore useful in diagnosis of congenital infections like syphilis, rubella, HIV, infection and toxoplasmosis. Name four causative organic agents for urinary tract infections. They include Klebsiella, Staphylococcus, Enterococcus faecalis, Group B Staphylococcus, Proteus mirabilis, Pseudomonas, and Staphylococcus aureus and Candida. Gram stain. Gram staining is a common technique used to differentiate two large groups of bacteria based on different cell wall constituents. The gram stain procedure distinguishes between gram positive and gram negative groups by coloring these red or violet. Gram positive bacteria stain violet due to presence of a thick layer of peptidoglycan in the cell walls, which retains crystal violet these cells are stained with. Alternatively, gram negative bacteria stain red, which is attributed to the thinner peptidoglycan wall, which does not retain this crystal violet during the decoloring process. Gram staining involves three processes: staining with a water soluble dye called crystal violet, decolorization, and counter staining, usually with the safanin. Due to the difference in thickness of peptidoglycan layer cell membrane between gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria, the gram-positive bacteria retain crystal violet stain during the decolorization process, while gram-negative bacteria lose the crystal violet stain and instead stain by the safrine in the final staining process. NIH swab. National Institute of Health swab is a cellophane paper is folded and tied to the tip of glass rod and inserted in the test tube. Cellophane end is applied to perianal region that removes spread of a blood. Eggs of microfilaria are deposited in large numbers in the perianal and perineal skin at night can be demonstrated by scraping this area by NIH swab in the morning before taking bath. Name four virus transmitted through the blood transfusion. They are dengue, HIV, hepatitis A, hepatitis B, C, Zika virus. Louis Pasteur. Louis Pasteur was the French chemist and microbiologist renowned for his discoveries for the principles of vaccination, microbial fermentation, and pasteurization. His research in chemistry led to a remarkable breakthrough in understanding of the cause and prevention of diseases, which laid down the foundations of hygiene, public health, and much of modern medicine. He is regarded as one of the founders of modern bacteriology and has been honored the father of bacteriology as the father of microbiology together with Robert Koch. Pasteur is also regarded as one of the fathers of germ theory of disease, which was the minor medical concept at that time. His works was credited as saving millions of people through the development of vaccines for the rabies and anthrax. Thank you. Thank you for listening.